God has been, in the last chapters, God has been bringing the plagues onto Egypt because of Pharaoh's hardness of his heart. His refusal to repent. He would not turn around. He would not repent of his sins and let Israel go. And every time Pharaoh has resisted letting them go, even at times when it made him break, he would only plead long enough for the plague to go away, that once it cleared up again, once when the plague got better and everything cleared up, he would go right back into being unrepentant again. I know you haven't done that, right? I've done it. I've done it many a times. Things get hard. Oh, Lord, help me get this off of me. And as soon as it let up, okay, I'm just going to go right back to doing it again. And that's what Pharaoh's doing. So every time a plague hit Pharaoh and he would not repent, you want to just get irritated at Pharaoh. It's like, you idiot, what are you doing? Let him go. Quit being so hard like that. But then you got to turn and look at yourself and go, wait a minute. I've done the same sort of thing. I have continued over and over again in sin. You know, God does not like partial repentance. He wants real, all-in, genuine, turn-around repentance all the way. But Pharaoh just will not give in because of his hard heart. And so they've gone through a series of plagues. Each one has gotten worse and worse. And some of the latter ones have come without warning. He used to get warning. Pharaoh would be warned, this is coming, better turn, better let the people go. And he wouldn't. Now they're starting to come without a warning at all. And like this one we're about to hear in Exodus 11 and verse 1. And the Lord said to Moses, I will bring one more plague on Pharaoh and on Egypt. Afterward, he will let you go from here. When he lets you go, he will surely drive you out of here altogether. Speak now in the hearing of the people, and let every man ask from his neighbor and every woman from her neighbor articles of silver and articles of gold. And the Lord gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians. Moreover, the man Moses was very great in the land of Egypt, in the sight of Pharaoh's servants, and in the sight of the people. Now that they were about to be delivered from out of there, the Israelites were to get silver and gold from the Egyptians, and who apparently were more kind to them than Pharaoh was. Even Moses himself was highly esteemed by Pharaoh's officials, and they had been competing against Pharaoh, against Moses all this time. They esteemed Moses as well, probably because of the miracles that they had seen through Moses, that had been working through Moses. Now, this helps explain why the Egyptians gave some of their expensive jewelry away to the Israelites. You may wonder, why did they just give it away to them? Because they were now highly esteemed. God said they were going to do it. Exodus 3 and 20, I want to show you. He had told them, so I will stretch out my hand and strike Egypt with all my wonders, which I will do in its midst. And after that, he will let you go. And I will give this people favor in the sight of the Egyptians, and it shall be when you go that you shall not go empty-handed. But every woman shall ask of her neighbor, namely of her who dwells near her house, articles of silver, articles of gold, and clothing, and you shall put them on your sons and on your daughters, so you shall plunder the Egyptians. And so now this has finally come to pass. This is actually going to come down as it was said, right? You know, when God says something's going to happen, it's going to happen. When God says Jesus is coming back, you better believe He's coming back. And I'm telling you, it could be any time. I hope if you're not right with the Lord now, you get right tonight, because He could come any time, right? So they're plundering the Egyptians because they have found favor with them, and now they're not going to go out of there empty-handed. Whatever the Israelites took from the Egyptians, I'm sure it was still not payment enough for the past 400 years of slavery that they had been through. They had been slaves to them. Exodus 11 and 4. Then Moses said, thus says the Lord, about midnight I will go out into the midst of Egypt, and all the firstborn in the land of Egypt shall die. Okay, pause a minute, Ray. That does not sound like the God I know. Well, let me introduce you to the God of the Bible. This is the God of the Bible. He actually does these things, okay? He says, I will go out in the midst of Egypt, and all the firstborn shall die. From the firstborn of Pharaoh who sits on his throne, even to the firstborn of the female servant who is behind the handmill, and all the firstborn of the animals. Then there shall be a great cry throughout all the land of Egypt, such as was not like it before, nor shall be like it again. But against none of the children of Israel shall a dog move its tongue, against man or beast. that you may know that the Lord does make a that you may know that the Lord does make a difference between the Egyptians and Israel. And all these your servants shall come down to me and bow down to me, saying, get out, and all the people who follow you. After that I will go out. Then he went out from Pharaoh in great anger. So like I said, some of the plagues came with no warning at all, right? Pharaoh had been resistant, and so now this plague is going to come with no opportunity for him to repent first. Quite a thought that a plague, a consequence of sin, is going to come upon you with no warning. No warning, no time to repent. You know what? I always say this, right now, today is a good time to get right with Jesus Christ, right now. Friends, the Lord actually does operate like this. He warns us to repent. He warns us to repent so that we can be right with Him. Friends, the Lord, He wants to warn us so that we can turn around and come to Jesus to be saved. If we continue on in willful sin, God might get to the point where He delivers harsh judgment, but with no warning first. That's quite a thought for me to think of. I have had warnings in my life. I've had people come up to me before and said, Ray, this is wrong. You need to repent. There may come a time when the warnings stop. Right now is a good time to get right with Jesus. I'll tell you what, for one thing, take my standing here right now. Wherever you are, I don't know everybody in the room, wherever you are in life, take this as your warning to get right with Jesus, because the judgment that could come, you may not get a warning for at all. It may be it. Good time to repent now. So in the 10th and final judgment, in every Egyptian family, the firstborn son would die in the middle of the night. And God was going to do this. God was going to kill them. Again, this is not the American Jesus we're used to hearing about. This is the God of the Bible, the real one. Now, a firstborn always received special favor. And so Pharaoh's son was going to be heir to the throne after him as the firstborn. And so Pharaoh's son also, just like Pharaoh himself, he was considered to be a god. He's going to die. Again, we're confronted with the question, why would God bring such chaos on the Egyptians? Remember, God is sovereign over all humanity. Our prosperity or judgment is not because of God's favoritism, but because He desires to accomplish His will. What God wants to do to accomplish His will, He will do. And not only that, He's putting this chaos on the people to wake them up, to save them from something infinitely worse, a place called hell. It really exists. It's in the Bible. I can show you a bunch of places of it. Jesus talks about it. I would rather you go through trial and tribulation here and wake up and repent, come to belief in Jesus and be saved, and avoid eternal condemnation. So for God to do this to Egypt is not unfair. We don't put God in our courtroom and say, God, you're not fair. We don't do that. God has a point to this. God is holy, which means set apart. He has authority over all. He has the right to do what He wills for His own purpose. And again, as I've said before, God actually saving people through this. So it's an act of mercy, not harshness. It's an act of mercy and grace by God to afflict them with these plagues now instead of letting them be condemned. Remember, we are the sinners here, right? I'm a sinner. I'm no better than any of you. Some of you may be in here thinking, I am so terrible. There's nobody as bad as me. Oh, yeah, there is somebody as bad as you, me. I'm as bad. I'm a sinner too. Okay? Satan wants you to think, nope, you're the worst one. You're all by yourself. You're not. We're all sinners. Okay? We're all sinners. We all deserve condemnation. Just remember what God had said to Pharaoh. He said in Exodus 9:16, He said, indeed, for this purpose I have raised you up, that I may show my power in you and that my name may be declared in all the earth. So it's not unfair for God to do these things that He's doing to Egypt. He's trying to proclaim His name to the whole earth so that everybody can go, oh, that's God, and wake up and be saved. That's why He's doing this. Remember, also the Egyptians are polytheists, meaning they had many, many false gods, a bunch of them. of those who refuse to worship the one true God of Israel. They make themselves objects of judgment. Objects of judgment. His wrath is going to fall on them. Read Romans 1. It's very clear on this. And so again, God is about to stomp all over the Egyptian belief system. The belief system of the Egyptians is they had gods for this and gods for that and gods all over the place. God is stomping all over their theology saying, I am just one God. There is just one God here. And now, tonight, he's about to take Pharaoh's own son, who's considered also to be a god. By killing the firstborn, he's showing that all of their gods can do nothing. They had a goddess named Osiris, I think it is, protector of their children. God's going to show them Osiris is non-existent. He does not exist. He's not real. The God of Israel is going to show he is the one true God. See, many people are going to come to believe through this. Even Egyptians. This ain't just for the Israelites to leave. A lot of Egyptians are gonna believe out of this. Those who are objects of God's wrath, they were never going to believe. They never were. God loves Israel because he said, I can set Israel apart from you. But even still, he was doing this for the Egyptians. It's really awesome. Now, in previous confrontations between Moses and Pharaoh, Moses gave him the opportunity to release the Israelites. But this time the plague is going to come and Moses is never going to give Pharaoh any warning about it. Never. Not on this last one. No chance to repent. Like I said, if you keep on in willful sin, don't go on and on thinking you've got the opportunity to repent forever. Well, I got plenty of time. I got a lot of time left. Do you have any guarantee that you'll be here tomorrow? I sure don't. I don't know what about you. We don't have any guarantee we'll be here. You got to get right. The repentance should come now. I've confronted people with repentance before and they say, well, I'll repent later. Well, pay attention to this story. Because Pharaoh's about to get a heavy one put on him with no warning to repent. It's a good chance, good time right now to get right with Jesus. Don't wait. And so now Moses was angry with Pharaoh as he walked out angry. This time, no chance to repent. He told Pharaoh, this time your servants are going to bow to me. And they're going to say, get out and everybody with you. That's pretty severe. That's pretty severe. Now they want them to leave. First they were like, no, you're not leaving. You got to stay here. You're our workforce. Now they're going to get to a point where they say, please get out. Go. We don't want you here. This time, the 10th plague, this was to be the work of God alone, heavily. Friends, sin and repentance is a serious issue. It's serious. I don't mean to try to scare you, but what's coming if you don't repent is worse than anything I can do. You know, sin is a serious issue. God takes it seriously. And America has invented a false God that says, I'll save everybody no matter what they do. No matter what lifestyle you pick, I'll save you. Just go right ahead. I just love you so much. I just want to throw blessings all over you. That is not the God here I'm reading about in God's Word. We have invented a false God here, and a lot of people follow that false God in America. It's going to get them in trouble. Exodus 11 and 9. But the Lord said to Moses, Pharaoh will not heed you, so that my wonders may be multiplied in the land of Egypt. So Moses and Aaron did all these wonders before Pharaoh, and the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he did not let the children of Israel go out of his land. They're referring to the previous, this part is referring to the previous plagues, is reminding us all these things that they did with Pharaoh that he would not let them go. So that's just kind of a little reminder there. But even with all that, still, Pharaoh's still not going to let him go. Still not going to let him go. I think 9 and 10 were written here to also give us an indication that if all of that wouldn't get Pharaoh to budge, then this 10th and final plague was going to be absolute terror. Absolute terror. However, in the midst of even absolute terror, God is going to establish His protection, His covering over His people, Israel, through what's called Passover, through Passover. And I'm glad we just arrived at Passover today during this time that people are calling Easter. You know what? Passover had a lamb, a Passover lamb. And I'm here to tell you, Easter ain't about bunnies. It's about a lamb. Easter is about a lamb. Get that bunny out. Don't be spotted with the world. Don't fall into American tradition. I know it's cute. I know it's fun. Easter's not about a bunny. It's about a lamb. We'll get to that. God is about to take Israel out of Egypt. So the Israelites were to receive a new identity as the people of the true God. Israel was about to begin their new history with a new calendar. You're about to go out of Egypt. I'm about to set you up with a new calendar from the time you're delivered out. So we see it here, Exodus 12 and 3. Speak to all the congregation of Israel. Sorry, I need a drink. Speak to all the congregation of Israel, saying, on the 10th of this month, here comes the calendar. On the 10th of this month, every man shall take for himself a lamb, according to the house of his father, a lamb for a household. And if the household is too small for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next to his house take it according to the number of the persons, according to each man's need. You shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. Now you shall keep it up. Now you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it at twilight. And they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and on the lintel of the houses where they eat it. Then they shall eat the flesh on that night, roasted in fire, with unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Do not eat it raw, nor boiled at all with water, but roasted in fire. Its head with its legs and its entrails. You shall let none of it remain until morning. And what remains of it until morning, you shall burn with fire. And thus you shall eat it, with a belt on your waist, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. So you shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. For I will pass through the land of Egypt on that night and will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt, I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. Now the blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And the plague shall not be on you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. So this day shall be to you a memorial, and you shall keep it as a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. You shall keep it as a feast by an everlasting ordinance. And you know, this is why I go to Passover. I attend a Passover Seder every year. We're supposed to do it. This is one of the holidays, one of the feasts I see in the Bible. So anyway, God's instructions on how to observe the Passover here are given. Now, the blood of the animals was to be placed on the door frames, the doorposts of the houses. The animal meat roasted, the people were to eat it with bitter herbs and unleavened bread. Now, the slaying of a lamb without blemish. I know some of you see the significance of that, and it's really cool. The slaying of a lamb without blemish, it's a perfect lamb, is a prefigure of our sinless Lord Jesus Christ, who is known as the Lamb of God, right? I love how John the Baptist said, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." The Lamb of God. I told you it's about a lamb, not a bunny. The reason they roasted the meat is because they weren't to eat it raw like pagans did. Pagans ate it more raw. The Israelites were God's people. They were set apart. You're mine. Don't be like pagans. Be like my set apart holy people. Don't eat like the pagans who worship false gods do. Now, the bitter herbs. I've had those bitter herbs on the Passover Seder, it's bitter. And when everybody gets to that part where they eat it, if you can tell sometimes people if it's their first Passover Seder, because they're like, you know, because I had a hard time with it myself. It don't taste good. It's bitter. The bitter herbs symbolize the sorrow and the grief of the bitter experience of all the oppression that they faced in Egypt all that time. It was a reminder. This was a bitter time. And they ate unleavened bread that they ate without leaven, which is not, leaven is yeast. They did not have time to wait for the bread to rise. In other words, They were eating unleavened bread because they were about to leave in a big hurry. God says, I'm going to come through and strike. Get ready to go. Okay? Eating unleavened bread symbolized the hurry that they were about to have to leave with. No waiting for the bread to rise. Now, God also instructed the people to eat the entire meal quickly while being ready and dressed for travel. If you see where it says there in verse 11, notice in verse 11, God says, you shall eat it with a belt on your waist, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. You shall eat it in haste. Eat it in a hurry. This is the Lord's Passover. Eat this. I'm about to get you out of here tonight. Be ready to go. I can just imagine after being stuck in Israel for 400 years, this is the night that he says, get ready to eat this Passover. Be ready to go. I'm like, yes, we're finally out of here after all this time. My great, 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 great grandpa, whatever, he couldn't have seen this coming, but now it falls on us. We're going to be out of here. All right, I'm getting my belt on. Let's get ready to go. Where's my shoes? You know, we're going. So you can see the urgency that God gave them here because he's going to have them get up and leave in a hurry that night. You know, 400 years of bondage and tonight's the night. All of this was to be done with the blood of the Lamb on the doorposts of their homes. Because right before the Lord was to have them get out of Egypt, he was going to pass through the land and strike all the firstborn, executing judgment. Now, what a terrifying night this was about to be. A terrifying night. Except for those with the blood of the Lamb. Right? God's method of his covering. If you don't have the blood of the Lamb, no reason to be afraid. But if you don't have the blood of the Lamb, you should be scared. You should be very scared. I want you to take notice, according to what we read, not your opinion, not my opinion, according to what we read in the standard of God's Word, who is going to strike the firstborn of Egypt? God. God. If you're thinking to yourself, you can't believe in a God that would do such a thing. Because you got to imagine, some of the firstborn could be just months old. Well, I can't believe in a God that would do such a thing. That's terrible. Well, no, wait a minute. This was a sinful people. This was a people that outright rejected God and worshiped false gods. Right? This is not the God who just lets everybody live however they want to. He'll just save everybody because he loves everybody so much. Doesn't matter how you live. Oh, you know. No, this is the God of Israel. This is the true God. The God of the Bible. Here, who he says who he really is. I want to show you in Isaiah 45:7. You won't hear this in prosperity preaching. It says, I form the light and create darkness. I make peace and create calamity. I, the Lord, do all these things. God does this. You look out in the world and you see calamity. Oh, God, save us. Who creates calamity? Well, Ray, you're going over the edge now. Well, there it is. It's either in the book or it's not. If it's there, I got to believe it. He does these things to wake people up, and he's doing this for Egypt, right? Friends, we have got to know who God really is, especially if we expect any blessing from him. And even more so, if we want to accurately represent who he is. You can't represent to other people who God is if you don't know who he is in the first place. You'll end up representing your own figment of your imagination of who you think God is. God is just, and so he executes judgment against sin. However, God is also, at the same time, he's also love. Ray, you're getting a little fire and brimstone on me here. Well, he's also love. And he's also graceful. He gives grace to those who are his. And the reason this is called Passover during this time that's coming up is because when the Lord saw the blood on the doorposts, he would pass over that house and not execute judgment on those who were under the blood of the Lamb. Pretty simple. Get under the blood of the Lamb, you're okay. If you're not, your choice. So when he saw the blood of the Lamb around that door, he would not strike those there with judgment. God is just, but he is also gracious. The thing for you to know is that it's much better to be under God's grace than to be under God's judgment. I'm thankful that He called me out and gave me the opportunity to repent. He warned me, repent, turn around, get out of that mess you're playing with, get out of that sin, get under the grace, under the blood of the Lamb, Jesus Christ, and you'll be fine. Get under the grace of God so that His judgment will pass over you too. See, God's mad at sin. Oh, He's mad. You've ever had your own kids or somebody cross you in the wrong way and it made you mad? God gets mad at sin. You've got to get under the blood of Christ. And so now in Exodus 11 and 15. 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread. On the first day you shall remove leaven from your houses. For whoever eats leavened bread from the first day until the seventh day, that person shall be cut off from Israel. On the first day there shall be a holy convocation, and on the seventh day there shall be a holy convocation for you. No manner of work shall be done on them, but that which everyone must eat, that only may be prepared by you. So you shall observe the feast of unleavened bread, for on this day, for on this same day, I will have brought your armies, I will have brought your armies out of the land of Egypt. Therefore, you shall observe this day throughout your generations as an everlasting ordinance. In the first month, on the 14th day of the month at evening, you shall eat unleavened bread until the 21st day of the month at evening. For 7 days, no leaven shall be found in your houses, since whoever eats what is leavened, that same person shall be cut off from the congregation of Israel. Whether he is a stranger or a native of the land, you shall eat nothing leavened in all your dwellings. You shall eat unleavened bread. So God then gave instructions for the Feast of Unleavened Bread as a national celebration of Israel's redemption from Egypt. Now the Passover and the Unleavened Bread feast, they're so closely connected, they're often considered one same feast, one single thing. And I'm really trying here, guys, because I'm not Jewish, I'm a Gentile. I'm a Gentile trying to teach you about Jewish feasts, so bear with me. The Feast of Unleavened Bread was for 7 days. Of course, no bread with yeast, which is leaven, was to be eaten on the Passover either. Homes were to have everything with yeast removed. Get all the yeast out of the house, because yeast or leaven is a symbol of sin. Get it out of your house. And I could tell you figuratively in the same way, get sin out of your house. Get it out of your life. Get it out of your dwelling. Get away from it. The absence of yeast suggests that those who are under the safety of the shed blood of the Lamb are free from the corruption of sin before God. You want to be free of corruption, don't you? We stand before God holy, set apart. I want to stand before God holy. I don't want to have unrepentant, willful sin hanging around in my life. Get the leaven out. If anyone ate anything with yeast during the feast of these days, he would be cut off from Israel. He would be separated from the covenant rights and privileges that they were supposed to get. Also, on the first and seventh days of the feast, the people were to gather together for special services. No work other than for food preparation to prepare the food. No work was to be done all week. And so, like the Passover, the Feast of Unleavened Bread was to be a lasting ordinance forever, for future generations, an ordinance to be obeyed, a ceremony to be observed. And the Passover was a festival which involved a sacrifice, because in the Passover, a lamb had to die, right? Exodus 12 and 21. Then Moses called for all the elders of Israel and said to them, "Pick out and take lambs for yourselves according to your families and kill the Passover lamb. And you shall take a bunch of hyssop, dip it in the blood that is in the basin, and strike the lintel and the two doorposts with the blood that is in the basin. And none of you shall go out of the door of his house until morning, for the Lord will pass through to strike the Egyptians. And when he sees the blood on the lintel and on the two doorposts, the Lord will pass over the door and not allow the destroyer to come into your houses to strike you. And you shall observe this thing as an ordinance for you and your sons forever. It will come to pass when you come to the land which the Lord will give you, just as He promised, that you shall keep this service. And it shall be when your children say to you, what do you mean by this service? That you shall say, it is the Passover sacrifice of the Lord, who passed over the houses of the children of Israel in Egypt when He struck the Egyptians and delivered our households. So the people bowed their heads and worshipped. Then the children of Israel went away and did so, just as the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron, so they did. Oh Lord, to be there that night, to have been there in Egypt that night, among the Israelites, when they all bowed their heads and worshiped together, that must have been some of the best worship that's ever been done on planet Earth. That had to be great. 400 years of bondage, and now they're going to get out, and God gave them a covering, and they worshiped. Could you imagine being there for that one? I just wish I could have been a fly on the wall to at least see it. I just can't imagine the passion in their worship that time. I bet it was overwhelming, if you think about it. So I just try to imagine it, and to think that that's nothing like the worship we're going to do once we get called home to heaven, right? Incredible worship that we're going to do when the Lord takes us. It just gets my mind going, you know. You follow the Lord Jesus and you will experience this. I'm doing the best I can to try to describe it, and what's left to our imagination doesn't even come close. It's going to be a great time. And so Moses gave the elders instructions for the Passover, just how God instructed them. The blood was to be placed on the door frames. It applied with hyssop. There's a picture of the hyssop plant right there. It was kind of used as a paintbrush that they used to paint it around. And so you'll see that hyssop is often used in Israel's rites of purification in Leviticus and Numbers. You'll see it mentioned about hyssop a lot. Now, something interesting here. Moses mentions in verse 23, he mentions the destroyer. The destroyer. Sounds pretty scary. He says, the Lord will pass over the door and not allow the destroyer to come into your houses to strike you. Let me ask you, we had already talked about this. Who is doing the striking here? Who's striking? God's doing it. God is doing the striking. The Lord is, we see that in verse 23, the Lord will strike the Egyptians. And so it's not for us to think that this destroyer is Satan, because that's kind of your first knee-jerk reaction. The destroyer would be Satan. That's not who this is. Because the Lord and the destroyer are both striking the Egyptians together in agreement. God and Satan don't operate in agreement, right? So I don't believe this destroyer here is Satan. I believe it is an angel of the Lord, because it's working with agreement, in agreement with God's will to execute His judgment. And so God's people were told to be sure to observe the Passover. It's kind of like, it's on you if you don't. Likewise, repentance and making Jesus your Lord, that's on you. You know, I can warn you till I'm blue in the face, but it's on you. He's telling them, observe the Passover. Also to observe it in the land that God had promised to give them, they were to teach its meaning to the children, so that when they say, hey, what's the service? What is this that we're doing? They'll say, this is the Passover, because the Lord passed over us and delivered us out of Egypt. And so now Exodus 12 and 29. The 10th plague, the death of the firstborn. And it came to pass at midnight that the Lord struck all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh who sat on his throne to the firstborn of the captive who was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of livestock. So Pharaoh rose in the night, he, all his servants, and all the Egyptians, and there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house where there was not one dead. You know, as much as I cannot imagine the greatness of the worship of the Israelites that I just spoke about, likewise, I can't imagine the sound of the terror of the Egyptians that night. That had to be absolutely terrible to think a whole nation, imagine like all these houses and all these people all the way around us, everybody and someone in every house just got killed. You could hear it. And Pharaoh got up in the night, and everybody got up in the night because it was so noisy, the terror, that it woke everybody up. Right? You know, we today, we stay up way past midnight because we got our gadgets and our electricity and all that. When I was hanging out with the Kuna Indians off the coast of Panama, when the sun went down, you went to bed. Because you can't see. You can't walk around and go anywhere. You have to go in your hut, and that's it. So the people, they were in bed as soon as the sun went down. So it's not like they were still up at midnight. It was the sheer terror of the sound of everyone dying that got everybody up. That it was so terrible. Great cry from Egypt as God destroyed the favored sons of every family, from royalty all the way to prisoners. Now this part of the story, again, this is the one real true God. This part of the story here represents the fury of God against sinners. Well, wait a minute, I'm a sinner. Is God mad at me? If you don't have the blood of Jesus over you, yeah. Got to get under the blood of Christ. The fury of God. But while Egypt is going through judgment, Israel is about to be released with blessing. God had said back in Exodus 3:19 that a mighty hand won't compel Pharaoh to let him go, but by his own hand, Pharaoh's going to release him. And so now God's mighty hand is on Pharaoh, who is up in the night because his own son has just died. Exodus 12:31. Then he called for Moses and Aaron by night and said, "Rise, go out from among my people, both you and the children of Israel, and go, serve the Lord as you have said. Also take your flocks and your herds as you have said, and be gone, and bless me also." And the Egyptians urged the people that they might send them out of the land in haste, for they said, "We shall all be dead." So God told Moses twice that Pharaoh would eventually get to the point of letting Israel go. Exodus 3:20 and Exodus 6:1 both record this. Pharaoh's going to tell you to get out, right? And so here we are, just as God said it would happen. It's finally happening. Pharaoh's telling them to get out. He told them to leave. But this time he said for them to leave with everything they had. Take everything that's yours and go. Get out of here. Now Pharaoh, who had always considered himself to be a god, he is now, what would you call it? He's gotten to a humbling place here right now of asking, because he asked Moses and Aaron to bless him. Imagine that, a man who thought he was king and a god, finally saying, "Bless me too." What a change. What a change, but it wasn't a full repentance, right? He wanted to be under God's blessing, not the curse of the plagues. And the people wanted the Israelites gone too because they were afraid they would die if Israel didn't get out. Get out of here, Israel. If you don't leave, we're all going to die. So go, get out of here, right? You know, hey, this demonstrates that when God wants to do something, He's going to do it. And He said, "I'm going to get Israel out of here." And He said, "The Egyptians are going to tell you to go. Pharaoh's going to tell you to go. We went through 9 plagues, they wouldn't do it, and now they are." When God says He's going to do something, He's going to do it, right? It's always best to be in God's will, with God's will, than against it. For those of you who think you're the greatest thing to ever walk the earth, and I know what that feels like because I used to be that. When I was 21, I was king of the universe. I was indestructible. I could do anything I wanted, and I was awesome. Okay? I see some of y'all going, thinking you were there too. God says when He wants to do something, He's going to do it. And when God wants to humble you, He's going to do it. I don't care how awesome you think you are, right? Just take a look at what God did to Pharaoh. God opposes the proud, but gives what? Grace to the humble. Some of y'all know that. Great. Exodus 12:34. So the people took their dough before it was leavened. See? They are getting out in a hurry. So the people took their dough before it was leavened, having their kneading bowls bound up in their clothes on their shoulders. Now the children of Israel had done according to the word of Moses, and they had asked from the Egyptians articles of silver, articles of gold, and clothing. And the Lord had given the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians so that they granted them what they requested. Thus they plundered the Egyptians. Remember, the Lord told them He was going to make things go down quick. He said it's going to go down fast. And here they are. They're in a hurry. They didn't have time to let the bread rise, so they took unleavened bread dough. Now the plagues, which proved God's power disposed the Egyptians favorably towards the Israelites, that they were willing to do anything they could to make their departure happen faster. The Egyptians were like, we will do anything we can to get you out of here before it kills us. So they said, give us some articles of silver and gold. Okay, here, take it, take it, take it, take it, get out. God said they were going to do this, right? This fulfilled God's promise that he said to Abraham way back in Genesis 15 and 13. Then he said to Abram, know certainly that your descendants will be strangers in a land that is not theirs and will serve them, and they will afflict them 400 years. And also the nation whom they serve, I will judge. Afterward, they shall come out with great possessions. And here it is. They're coming out with great possessions, just like God said was going to happen. The promise being fulfilled, plundering them, without resistance, mind you. When I think of plundering, I think of a fight. This was plundering with no problem. Take it. Go. Okay? It's almost like getting compensation for 400 years of bondage. When God makes a promise, does He not deliver it? He delivers it. And plus, I want to let you know that if you will submit yourself to Jesus as Lord, and He says, you do that, I'll save you. Trust me, when God says it, He promises it, He can do it and He will, right? God's great because He does deliver. Exodus 12 and 37. Then the children of Israel journeyed from Ramesses, I think it's Ramses, to Succoth. About 600,000 men on foot, besides children. A mixed multitude went up with them also, and flocks and herds, a great deal of livestock. And they baked unleavened cakes of the dough which they had brought out of Egypt, for it was not leavened, because they were driven out of Egypt and could not wait, nor had they prepared provisions for themselves. Now the sojourn of the children of Israel who lived in Egypt was 430 years. And it came to pass at the end of the 430 years, on that very same day, it came to pass that all the armies of the Lord went out from the land of Egypt. It is a night of solemn observance to the Lord for bringing them out of the land of Egypt. This is that night of the Lord, a solemn observance for all the children of Israel throughout their generations. Now, a little over 600,000 Israelite men. Now, Numbers 146 talks that maybe a closer figure was 603,000 men. This first one in Exodus just kind of rounded off. But if you include women and children, the number of Israelites, because it only numbered the men, if you add the women and children, the number could have come around very well easily to about 2 million people. 2 million. Along with them were non-Israelites of an unknown number. So there's people who weren't Israelites that went out with them. So later on in the wilderness, we're going to see that they caused the Israelites to complain against Moses. But right now, they're heading out together with them as well. And so Moses concluded this section about the Exodus with a historical reminder of God's faithfulness by saying that the length of Israel's time in Egypt was 430 years. Now, I believe that Moses authored this reminder here about God's care of the Israelites on the night of the Exodus because it should be remembered. This is something that should be remembered. In fact, in many books of the Bible later on, we'll see that we're reminded again because God says, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt. He reminds them again and again, I brought you out of Egypt. This was an event to be remembered for all time. All time. We're about to wrap up here. Exodus 12 and 43. And the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, this is the ordinance of the Passover. No foreigner shall eat it, but every man's servant who is bought for money, when you have circumcised him, then he may eat it. A sojourner and a hired servant shall not eat it. In one house it shall be eaten. You shall not carry any of the flesh outside the house, nor shall you break one of its bones. All the congregation of Israel shall keep it. And when a stranger dwells with you and wants to keep the Passover to the Lord, let all his males be circumcised, and then let him come near and keep it. And he shall be as a native of the land, for no uncircumcised person shall eat it. One law shall be for the native born and for the stranger who dwells among you. Thus all the children of Israel did as the Lord commanded Moses and Aaron. So they did. And it came to pass on that very same day that the Lord brought the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt according to their armies. You know, I'm not Jewish, as I said. As a Gentile, reading this right here, I love knowing that when I come to believe in Jesus as Lord and Savior, then I am grafted into the Jewish people. For those of you who are Jewish, it is a blessing to partake of Passover. You're Jewish, you get to partake of Passover. But for Gentiles like me, we are blessed that we can join in. As it says in verse 48, check this out. This is cool. Verse 48, when a stranger, that's me, the Gentile, right? When a stranger dwells with you and wants to keep the Passover to the Lord, let all his males be circumcised, and then let him come near and keep it, and he shall keep it as a native of the land. Like a Jewish person, like an Israelite. How cool. I am circumcised of the heart because Jesus is my Lord. And so I'm blessed with being able to partake of the Passover. I went to my first Passover Seder and I was surrounded by Jewish people. They had yarmulkes on and I didn't. I felt different, okay? It's like, I felt like I'm intruding upon them. Like, I'm really not supposed to be here. Like, I'm just kind of running into their house and like messing things up, you know? I'm just being honest. That's how I felt. I didn't understand this. In Jesus, circumcised the heart, you can partake of Passover like a native. And I'm like, wow, this is for me too. See, God didn't call some and then leave the rest of you out. We all get grafted in. It's all one big family. It's really nice. It's a blessing. And I want to close now. Like I said, we run a little long, but we're going to close down now. Andrew, can I get you to just strum something quiet? It doesn't have to be anything particular. You know, I know that today is called Easter by many people. We're seeing that. It's called Easter. I like calling it Resurrection Day. That's when Jesus Christ rose. We celebrate that. I don't like to give credit to calling it Easter. We're not going to debate that here, but we just like to keep it biblical. You have to admit, there's nothing biblical about the fact that we've allowed crazy traditions to slip into our thinking when we take something as holy, as the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And by the way, holy means set apart. It's supposed to be set apart and kept to itself. For us to take something as holy as the resurrection of Jesus Christ and then mix it up with bunnies and eggs, it's just a thing we shouldn't do. But it's our culture telling us to do that. We should not be spotted by the world. It's about the Lamb of God and the resurrection so that we can be saved. If we're going to keep it holy, then let's keep it holy. Set apart. Don't mix up with the world. I didn't read anything about a bunny in Exodus, did you? I'm not going to knock that too hard, but I'm just trying to emphasize the point. Stay in the truth. The truth. Jesus died for us to have eternal life. We are not to bring myth into it. God took this seriously, and so should we. Jesus is our Passover lamb. Again, John the Baptist, when he saw Jesus, he said, "Behold the Lamb of God, which takes away the sins of the world." Our Passover lamb. And the Israelites ate unleavened bread during Passover. Unleavened bread, bread without yeast. It's because they were in a hurry and didn't have time for the baking to rise. But in the Bible, leaven or yeast always indicates sin. Sin. 1 Corinthians says a little bit of leaven, a little bit of sin, makes its way through the entire lump of dough. You got that dough, you're working for bread. A little bit gets in there, goes through the whole thing. We want to keep this congregation clean and pure. We want you to live a life of blessing in God. So go home and get the leaven out of your house. Get the leaven, get the sin out of your life so that you can come in here and worship and study God's Word in its purity and its holiness, and you can affect other people in good and encouraging ways because your sin will rub off. Guess what? So will the righteousness of Jesus too. It'll rub off as well. And so the sin of leaven will spread in a person, then it will spread in a church, and then it will spread into a nation. And that's what we have out there today. Leaven all through our country. I love America. And the only way that this country is going to come back to anything is through repentance. It ain't going to be no elected official can pull it off. We must repent of our sin, because sin is exactly why Jesus died on the cross as our Passover lamb in the first place. So repent. Don't let leaven work its way through your lump of dough. 1 Corinthians 5:7, therefore purge out the old leaven that you may be a new lump, since you truly are unleavened. For indeed, Christ, our Passover, was sacrificed for us. See, there's our Passover right there. The lamb that the Israelites used for Passover had no blemish, no defect. It was a spotless lamb. It had no error to it. James 1 tells us to be unspotted from the world, like the spotless lamb without blemish. 2 Corinthians 5:21. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. And so the Israelites that put the lamb's blood on their doorposts, so that when the Lord saw the blood, he would pass over them and not strike them with judgment. Again, with Jesus as our Passover lamb, you need the blood of Jesus on you. You need the blood of Jesus on the doorposts of your heart, so that when God's wrathful judgment comes upon all sinners that who have violated His law, and that's all of us, I violated God's law, but when His judgment comes, if you have the blood of Jesus on you, He will see it, and then He will pass over you, and He will not allow the destroyer to strike you, just like He did with the Israelites on Passover night. 1 Peter 1:18 says, you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers. That's why I struck down the tradition of Easter. But you're redeemed with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. There's our Passover lamb again. We've been redeemed. That means we've been bought back unto God. You're not your own. You've been paid for. Somebody bought you. Jesus Christ bought you. This is why Jesus is the only way to eternal life, because He's the only spotless lamb that could die for all the sins of the world. Don't let any politically correct worldly thinker tell you that all roads lead to heaven. They don't. God gave Israel only one way to be saved from the destroyer, only by the blood of a spotless lamb on their doorpost, so that He would pass over them and not strike them. And the same goes for us today. Only the blood of Jesus Christ can save you from destruction and cause the judgment of God's wrath to pass over you. This is what Jesus said in John 14:6. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Only Jesus is our Passover lamb. But not everybody has the blood of Jesus on them. Not everybody has the blood on their doorposts. Some of you here today might be concerned about yourselves. You might be thinking, I'm not sure if I have the blood on my doorposts or not. I'm afraid that if the Lord's destroyer comes, He will strike me for being a sinner. If you're thinking like that, then I have good news for you. You can choose to make Jesus your Lord, your boss, tonight, today, right where you sit. And then you will have the blood of Jesus on you, God's free gift of eternal life. But you can't have the blood of Jesus on you if you refuse to repent of your sins. Pharaoh would not repent. He would not let Israel go. Plague after plague after plague after plague came, and he still would not repent. And then a plague came without warning. And then it was too late. So what I'm trying to say today, while you have time now to receive this warning, which tonight could be your last warning. Don't know. Now's a good time to get right with Jesus Christ. Make Him your Lord. Get the blood of Christ on you. Friends, now I'm giving you a warning. Get right with Jesus. Repent. Let Jesus be your Lord. Hebrews 9:27 says, as it is appointed for men to die once, but after this the judgment. Don't think that you have years to repent. Today could be your last warning. You have no guarantee you'll be here tomorrow. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm trying to see that you come to belief and get saved in Jesus Christ. Every single day, tens of thousands of people step over the line into eternity. And most of them had no idea that today was their turn. They didn't know they were going. Israel was held slave in Egypt. God sent them a deliverer, Moses, to lead them out to the promised land. We are slave here on this earth. But God also sent us a deliverer to lead us to the promised land of eternal life. And that deliverer, His name is Jesus Christ, the Passover Lamb. And today could be the day for you to get the leaven out of your house, repent of your sins, and fully submit yourself to Jesus Christ. And by doing so, making Him Lord, you will put the blood of the Lamb on the doorpost of your heart, and God's judgment will pass over you. And like the Israelites, when our deliverer, Jesus Christ, takes us out of here, He gave them great abundance. When the Lord takes us out of here, we're going to have great abundance too. And that's the riches of grace in Christ Jesus. That's the significance of the resurrection. Growing up, and I'm almost done, growing up, I did not know the significance of the resurrection. I always heard Jesus died and paid the price for your sins, and that's all I heard. If Jesus did not rise from the dead, there would be no victory. There would be no life, there would be no hope for any of us. But He did. He rose again from the grave. And the Bible says that because death no longer has mastery over Him, death no longer has mastery over you if you believe in Jesus Christ. So we're done, but I want to ask you, if tonight you've not been sure where you stand with God, I want to let you know right now, you can be sure. Make Jesus Christ your Lord. Pray with me, and you have to agree with me. I can't pray it for you, but pray with me if you want to accept this free gift, if you want to have God pass over you with His judgment and be taken to eternal life. Pray with me. Father God, we thank You for this story You've given us here in Exodus. Lord God, we thank You. You sent us a deliverer to deliver us from our bondage of sin. Lord, I'm praying on behalf of those who wish to make You Lord tonight. And as they agree with me, they will pray this. Lord God, I want You to help me to remove the leaven from my house. Show me, Lord God, what has to get out of my life. I want to repent. I want to be right before You. Jesus, I am no longer the boss of my life. I no longer do things my way. Jesus, now I want to do things Your way. I'm making You Lord. You now control my life. My worries and the things that have plagued me, I let them go to You. They will not concern me. They won't own me. Lord, You own me now. Lord, take care of my life and protect me. And please, thank You. Give me the gift of grace of eternal life that You offer. I want Your blood upon me. Lord Jesus, You are my Passover Lamb. I'm thankful that You defeated death and rose again. Lord, I want to be with You forever. Thank You for eternal life, and thank You, Lord God, for saving me. As His Word says, that if you will confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. Thank You, Lord, for saving me and for You yourself being my Passover Lamb. Thank You for life. In Jesus' name, amen.